desire this. Men and people will fight it down. Tell me why.
When you see childlike.
Let me tell you, if you're not wrong, then why?
Everything is alright.
So we're gonna walk. Alright.
Through the roads of creation.
Good day, lecturer and colleagues. My name's Imani and this is my tutorial presentation. So for my presentation, I decided to do question number 2, which asks that I choose 2 leaders from the list of leaders that was provided and analyze their individual impacts on the Rastafarian movement. And the leaders that I decided to do my report on are Marcus Garvey and Leonard Howell. And as you can see from the PowerPoint slide that is now being displayed, there are some dictionary definitions that I went ahead and added for you guys to, I don't know if you want to read it or make jottings of it, but these are dictionary definitions and each of them are appropriate for defining the term Rastafarianism. Rastafarianism is an extremely important and powerful part of Jamaica's cultural heritage. The religious community was originated in the island of Jamaica during the 1930s. For Rastafarians island-wide, the religion symbolized a sense of belonging and identity. The emergence of the faith now meant that no longer did they serve a white king, but instead Haile Selassie of Ethiopia. Rastafarians were extremely passionate about a few things, and repatriation is most certainly one of them. A great deal of the people's mission is to get themselves and their people back to the motherland, which is Ethiopia. The country is incredibly significant for Rastafarians, as it is the home of the Most High Haile Selassie. Okay, so the Rastafarian movement has come a long way since the emergence of the community. Rasta have faced a great deal of discrimination, harassment, and just overall unfair and unjust treatment because of their religious orientation, beliefs, and their overall way of life. It is even worse that Rastafarians are generally treated without respect because the culture of Rasta contributes to the marketing of the island. And even if you haven't went ahead and done formal research on this, I'm sure that there's empirical evidence or you've observed that Rastafari's culture is a great marketing tool for the island of Jamaica where tourism is concerned. On a yearly basis, a lot of persons from all over the world come to Jamaica to experience the culture and have a better understanding of what Rastafarianism is. Okay. And as you can see from the slide that is now being displayed, I went ahead and added some symbols of Rastafarianism. They're going to be skipped gradually as I continue with my presentation. Okay, so as we stated in the paragraph above, the culture of Rastafari has come a long way. It has gained popularity all over the globe and opens up opportunities for not only Rastafarians, but Jamaicans in general. The Rastafarians have had to fight against discrimination for many decades. It is nearly impossible to think of Rastafari without considering many pioneers, 2 of which include Leonard Howell and Marcus Garvey. Okay, so from the slide that is now being displayed, this is a picture of the late Leonard Howell, and the information that is presented on the slide is just some general but significant information about the late Howell. Okay, so Leonard Howell is an extremely significant figure in the Rastafarian movement. The late Howell was born in Clarendon, Mebad, Jamaica in 1898 and died in Kingston 1981. Prior to his passing, Howell had a relatively eventful life. He traveled to different regions of the world to study and work, some of which includes Panama and New York, but eventually returned to the island of Jamaica. Leonard Howell is the founder of the Rastafarian movement in the island of Jamaica. He believed that black people were oppressed by white supremacy, and his own experiences as a black man was the driving force behind the Rastafarian movement. Howell wanted to fully express his African identity and part ways with the European, with what the Europeans had forced upon black people. He emphasized that Haile Selassie was the second coming of Christ and is therefore God in flesh. He then introduced the concept of Rastafarianism, where he preached that Haile Selassie of Ethiopia is the King of Kings. So the photograph that is now being displayed on the screen is one of Haile Selassie, the King of Kings and the Emperor of Ethiopia in 1930 through 1974. And during the process of trying to gain overall equality for black people and freedom from the colonial culture entirely, Leonard Howell had faced some challenges. You know, in 1934, he was arrested for speaking out against the Jamaican government and the ways in which he observed black people were being treated in the country. So that is one of the challenges that Leonard Howell had faced while he was advocating for black people in Jamaica.
It is for me to inform you that the Universal Negro Improvement Association is an organization that seeks to unite into one solid body the 400 million Negroes of the world, to link up the 15 million Negroes of the United States of America with the 20 million Negroes of the West Indies, the 40 million Negroes of South and Central America with the 280 million Negroes of Africa, for the purpose of bettering our industrial, commercial, educational, social, and political conditions. As you are aware, the world in which we live today is divided into separate race groups and distinct nationalities. Each race and each nationality is endeavoring to work out its own destiny to the exclusion of other races and other nationalities.
In addition to the remarkable and inspiring works of Leonard Howell, another significant contributor to the practice is Marcus Garvey. Marcus Garvey was a Jamaican political activist who significantly influenced the lives of Jamaican people. More specifically, Marcus Garvey was an influential figure in the Rastafarian movement. Garvey never considered himself to be a follower of Rastafari. Nonetheless, his work and ideologies developed the movement. Similarly to the Rastafarian community, Garvey advocated for black liberation and self-reliance. In the year of 1914, Garvey started the Universal Negro Improvement Association. As the name suggests, this organization was put into action by Marcus Garvey in attempts to promote overall advancement of black people globally. Okay, so Marcus Garvey envisioned a world where black people had the comfort of freedom, unity, inclusivity, and just overall advancement and improvement in their lives. And he believed that the Universal Negro Improvement Association was an appropriate means of obtaining this goal. Regrettably, in 1923, Marcus Garvey was convicted for mail fraud. After serving some of what his original sentence was meant to be, Garvey was deported back to Jamaica, where he continued his work and his activism movement. So ultimately and conclusively, both of these remarkable leaders saw where black people were still being treated unfairly. There was still inequality, there was no solidarity, unity, there was a lot of discrimination and prejudice, there were injustices that were inflicted upon black people, and both of these leaders witnessed the happenings of these occurrences, and they then went ahead and took matters into their own hands. In Marcus Garvey's case, his work significantly inspired the lives of Rastafarians. It inspired the movement dearly, and Rastafarians hold Marcus Garvey closely to their hearts. And in Leonard Howell's case, his work and his want for equality for black people and freedom from the colonial mindset actually started the Rastafarian movement. So that is it for my presentation. These are my references, and thank you very much.